just speak about who they are. And this verse in Acts 4, verse 13 came to mind, and it says this. Now when they saw, this is the people, they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. And the part that struck gold for me with Gunter and Trish is that when I spent time with them, I realized that they've been spending time with Jesus. And it is just, you guys are such a testimony of the light of God. You just carry the presence of Jesus wherever you go. And we're just blessed to have you share again here tonight. Let's just introduce Gunter and Trish.
Lovely to have you all here tonight. Yeah, Lord, we just thank you, Jesus, especially we just welcome your presence. We know that your presence, where your presence is, there's heaven. That, Lord, we have not just come to Emmanuel Church, but we are joining with the heavenly Jerusalem. We are part of the heavenly Jerusalem. Lord, we've come to the new Jerusalem, the city of angels in festal gathering, the church of the firstborn. We just welcome you, Jesus. You are awesome. You're amazing. You are our all. We love you, Jesus, with all of our hearts. You're amazing. You're amazing. We welcome your presence. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. You are the now presence of Jesus, the now presence of our Father. You are King. We welcome you, Jesus. Welcome you, Father. Welcome you, angels. Welcome heaven. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for, Lord, just every person here that we are your children. We are born of you. We are your bride. We are one spirit with you. Thank you for this awesome time that we can spend together. And we just ask, Holy Spirit, that you just speak to us tonight, that which you have been putting on my heart over the last couple of weeks. Awesome time that we're living in right now. We just ask, Holy Spirit, that you just take over. Holy Spirit, we come to sit at your feet and we just pray that you minister your love to us, the grace of the Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We welcome your presence. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. I didn't realize we're going to do communion, but it's part of what God's asked me to share tonight. Yeah, I just wanted to say, first of all, you know, it's all about Jesus, like Matt is. Thank you, Matt, for introducing us, and thank you, Lindley. It's lovely to have you with us, Matt, everyone else. And yeah, Jesus, as you always know, he's always present in and around us. So he's an ever-present God. You can't run away from him. And where his presence is, there's heaven. So just realize you are right now. You are actually, you know, heaven is not a faraway place. It's just another realm. And you are experiencing heaven right now. And you're actually part of heaven. You are, the Bible says, we are ambassadors from heaven. And heaven is our real home. So Jesus is love personified. You know, Matt said so beautifully the other day at Awesome. He said, when you meet Jesus, you meet everything there is. Isn't that amazing? Everything there is, because he is the great I am. There's nothing beside him. There's no one beside him. So he is so awesome. And he is love personified. He is joy personified. So when you meet Jesus, you meet love. You meet joy. He is brokenness personified. He is such a beautiful person. So he's always the broken-hearted father. In him, the father is manifest. He is compassion personified. And he loves you passionately. Whether you realize it or not, he loves you passionately, as if there's no one else. Now the Holy Spirit, just speaking about the communion, the Holy Spirit, he is a manifestation of everything. So he's a manifestation of Jesus. He's a manifestation of the Father. He is a manifestation, the realization of our covenant that we have with the Father and the Son. So the Holy Spirit, he uses everything to conform us. He's got one plan, and that is to conform all of us to the image and likeness of Jesus. Because Jesus is the ultimate blueprint. He is the invisible likeness of the invisible. He is the visible likeness of the invisible God. So we are, individually and corporately, we are the new Jerusalem. So you know, in the Old Testament, God lived, this is amazing. He lived in Jerusalem. He chose Jerusalem to be his dwelling place on earth. Initially, you know, he was in the tent in the wilderness. And then later on, he was in Jerusalem. And specifically, there was a mountain, which is still there now, if you go to Jerusalem, Mount Zion, and which is a temple mount. And on Mount Zion, there was a temple. And God's dwelling place on earth was in that temple on Mount Zion. And now the Bible says we are now Mount Zion. We are Mount Zion. We are that temple. We are the temple of God. And God is enthroned in us. Isn't that awesome? So you are individually and corporately, you are the new Jerusalem. You are Mount Zion. You are the temple of God, and God is enthroned in you. That makes you absolutely awesome. So God is enthroned in our very innermost being. So Jesus said, John, I think it's John 7, he said, he who believes in me, okay? So that means he who identifies with me, out of his innermost being will flow a stream of living water. So as we believe in Jesus, we realize he lives inside of us, and out of that, from underneath that throne, Revelation 21, it speaks about that there's a river of life flowing from that throne. And we are that throne of God. Isn't that awesome? So God in Jeremiah, he already said, I will no longer live in buildings made with human hands. So often we still talk about going to church, but we are the church. So God lives inside of us, and we are his dwelling place. So we are, as you know, we are sons of God because we are born of God. We are born of his Spirit. And like normal, natural children, we are born of God. And so we are born of his Spirit, and we are really children of God. So he sees himself mirrored in us, just like you see yourself mirrored in your children. And he's overwhelmed with love for every one of us. And we are Jesus' co-equal bride. So often that's, you know, might be a bit difficult for guys to understand. But just as ladies, you know, we are all sons of God, whether you are male or female. So it's not a male or female thing to be a son of God. Because in God there's both male and female. So it's not a gender thing, it's a spirit thing. We are sons of God. And we are the bride of Christ, both male, guys and girls. We are the bride of Christ, okay? So God, he knows that we need to experience a father. So he is a father to us. See, the father, the perfect father to us, he's a perfect bridegroom to us. He knows that we need to experience romance. We need to feel like we're the only one. We need to be loved like in a bridal way. So the bride gets her identity from Jesus. So I want to speak, I'm speaking tonight, my subject really tonight is the unveiling of Christ and his bride. And I really believe it's imminent right now. It's the time that we're living in. You know, when darkness, the Bible says, when darkness covers the earth and dense darkness the people, the Lord shall arise upon you and his glory shall be seen on you. So I think most of you know Brian Simmons from the Passion Translation. Just a comment, a footnote on Proverbs 31:29, where he's speaking about the glorious end time church. He says, this final generation will be the bridal company of the lovers of God who do mighty exploits and miracles on the earth. So God's always known, he's always known this chaos that's going on at the moment. He's known this, you know, that that without him, you know, Jesus gave that story. He said there were two people, one built his house on sand, the other one built his house on the rock. And the storm came, and the house that was built on sand fell. So we are seeing at the moment that the systems of mankind are shaking. Things are shaking. And whatever is not built on the rock, which is Jesus Christ, is going to fall. So God's plan from the beginning of time has always been there will be a bride that's unveiled in the end time. And God's passion has always been his bride. Jesus' passion has always been his bride. It's what he lives for. And so he knows that he's known that things are going to shake, and he's looking for a bride that will co-reign with him from heaven to earth. And we're living in that time of the unveiling of the bride. So, you know, if you look at the book of Revelation, the name of the book of Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ, or the unveiling of Christ. That's the title of Revelation. And specifically, the unveiling of Christ in his bride. Isn't that awesome? So we are already in covenant with our Father through the Son. So we know that on the cross, which is actually the communion is a picture of the covenant that we have with our Father through Jesus Christ. And so we, as Jesus said, he said, when you eat this bread, which symbolizes my body, drink this wine, which symbolizes my blood, remember me, okay? So we do it in remembrance of the covenant, that awesome covenant that Jesus Christ made with the Father on our behalf. And we participate in that covenant by faith. So it's awesome to know, you know, as things are shaking all around us, we are in covenant with the Father. And every promise is yes and amen in Christ. We are in Christ by faith. And so we don't have to fear as people in the world do that are not in faith. Psalm 91 is amazing. It says, though 1,000 fall at our right hand, 10,000 at our left, it will not come near us because we've made the Lord our refuge, the Most High our dwelling place. So we are in covenant with the Father, and the Holy Spirit, he's the administrator of that covenant. So he makes it real to us. So he wants us tonight, I just really trust that he's gonna make this covenant so real with the Father for us that we really experience. So the Holy Spirit is literally, he is that life of that covenant. So Jesus, you know, he shed his blood on our behalf. He came into covenant. You know, the Bible says without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. Jesus became that sacrificial lamb on our behalf. And we can experience the reality of that, the love of the Father. That, you know, the Father so loved the world that he gave up his only begotten Son. The Son so loved the world that he gave himself for the world. He gave himself for his bride. And, you know, the Bible says that when Jesus' last words on the cross were, you can read this in the Passion Translation, was, "It is finished, my bride." How's that? So he did it for his bride. So the Father, he's our Heavenly Father. We are his children. Jesus is our bridegroom. And he gave up his life for us. So we have this awesome communion. And so I actually had a vision this, I think about a week ago or so, where I saw the Father and the Son making communion on our behalf, making covenant on our behalf, and the Holy Spirit standing by, and he's like the realization of that covenant. So we can experience that full love of the Father, the full love of our bridegroom on our behalf through the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is both, he's the life of the covenant, he's the blood of the covenant, his love has been poured out in our hearts so that we can actually experience that fullness. And I'm really going to trust tonight you're going to experience that. And in the same way, so also I saw, God gave me a vision of Jesus, the bridegroom, together with his bride. Don, I just want to show you. My bride. So I saw Jesus holding the bride's hands and looking into her eyes, and he was he was overwhelmed with love for his bride. And the Holy Spirit, it was like they were getting married, and the Holy Spirit was like, you know, like you have a pastor when the husband and the wife get married, the bridegroom and the bride get married. And so the bridegroom was looking into his bride's eyes, and she was, as the Holy Spirit was giving her revelation of how much the bridegroom loves her, she was overwhelmed with his love. She was overwhelmed with the love of the bridegroom. And she became completely like in love, intoxicated with the love of the bridegroom. Yeah, so the Holy Spirit, when we realize the Holy Spirit, he's that full love of the bridegroom. He's the love of the Father. He's the love of the bridegroom, and he's able to reveal that to us. Can we just play the first song, please? We're just going to play a song, so if you can just listen with your hearts, and then Trish is going to do something awesome. Maybe just close your eyes and just listen with your hearts. Thank you, Jesus. So, yeah. As I said, we're living in a time of like the culmination of all things, and specifically the unveiling of the bride, and in the unveiling of Christ in his bride. And so it's as the bride realizes that Christ lives inside of her, that she is unveiled. So the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 4, it says, God who spoke out of darkness has shone his light into our hearts for the illumination of the glory of and majesty of God in the face of Jesus. So the Holy Spirit wants to unveil to the bride that Christ lives inside of her. And when she realizes Christ is in her, she is unveiled. The full beauty of the bride is unveiled. So a picture of that is, you know, we often speak about the Lion King, when Simba looks into the water and he sees his father in him. From that moment, he comes into his true identity. So we're living in the time where the Holy Spirit is unveiling the true identity of the bride. And the end time bride is going to be fearless as she realizes Christ himself lives inside of her. And, you know, as I've mentioned before, David, type and shadow of that in the Old Testament, King David says, I've set the Lord continually before me at my right hand, therefore I will not be moved. Though the earth be shaken, the mountains fall into the sea, I will not be moved. And, you know, as the bride realizes that Christ himself lives inside of her, her full beauty is unveiled. And it's through the Holy Spirit just giving her revelation of Christ inside of her. So I'm just going to, you know, you all know that the Bible says that marriage is a picture of Christ and his church. And so, you know, when Trish and I got married, she's going to talk about that, we realized, you know, how true that was, that there's a revelation that comes through marriage, through a marriage between a man and a woman. There's a revelation of Christ and his bride that comes. So I'm just going to ask Trish to come forward and just share on that.
Yeah, it's been amazing because this week we'd had a prophetic word about this beautiful big white book, that there was something special in this book that God's got for us. And I knew immediately God was talking about our wedding album. We'd had it in storage for a couple of years. And so we opened up this beautiful wedding album, and it was so beautiful. Gunter spoke to me this week on Monday, and he said, Trish, God's just speaking to me about bridal intimacy. And he just said this romance is just like stirring in the air. And we started looking at our wedding pictures again. And, you know, there was something so redemptive about our wedding. And we were married, it was almost 30 years ago, and it was two families coming together, and there was such brokenness that we'd both come out of. And it's so beautiful, because we're just going to show you a short video clip of our wedding. And, you know, God had given me a promise when I gave my heart to the Lord. It was a full surrender. When I became a believer, it wasn't just go to church and see how people do it. It was something I did on my own. In my bedroom, I encountered God. I encountered the Holy Spirit. I came into this realization that there's someone with me, there's someone in me. And he started to teach me just sensitively, this was before I went to a church, how to communicate and how to recognize his voice and how to interact with the Spirit, which was the most beautiful journey. And it was like he was my lover. And I would go I would want to escape to places to be with him, you know, like you do a lover. And so in my busyness of being a single mom and children, I used to escape to this beautiful place in the gorge where there was this gorgeous rock. And I used to, this was my little hideaway, is to go and sit on this rock. And you know that song that we heard earlier, it says your failure doesn't define you. And there had been a lot of failure in my life. But encountering him, I would now go and sit on that rock, the rock where I, many years before, would sit on with a feeling of death and depression and suicide, actually. I would be excited to get to that rock. And on my way, I know I'm going to that rock. I'm going to meet with my lover. This anticipation would rise up in my heart as I would drive close to this getaway. And I would walk, and this excitement in my heart would start to beat. And I would sit on the rock. And, you know, it was so beautiful because the presence of God would just come on me so beautifully. And there was this intimacy and just this knowing of he's mine and I'm his. And the surrender in my heart was so deep that I did not want to remarry. I didn't want anything to clutter this intimacy. And when the Lord did bring somebody along, I actually surrendered my heart to a point of a surrender, ever having a husband, a wedding, got two children, that's enough. I surrendered everything. And I just saw when the Father brought Gunter into my life, it was so beautiful because we got married and the photographer, we said we want some beautiful pictures in the mountains. He took us to the exact rock of my rock. And it was so beautiful because when I got baptized, I remember escaping that day. It was on my birthday. I was 30. To that rock, my rock. And I remember birthdays were never anything in my life. I'd never celebrated them. It wasn't something we really did in our family. And I remember when I got baptized, going to that rock and just the presence of God and just the glory and just encountering, there's someone here. This is not a journey of going to somewhere to experience. It's something of someone being with you permanently, encountering this love. And so the photographer chose that exact rock. And what is so beautiful, you'll see the picture of our kids on the rock with us, the redemption of Christ, is Gunter told me soon into our courtship that the rock that I used to look at, and you'll see it in the pictures, is where he used to go every morning at 5:30 and just worship God. Used to go for a run, and just the presence of God was so thick. So for a couple of years before I met him, we were actually probably could have seen each other. And so this is just the beauty of how the Holy Spirit works in people's lives, his redemption. And so one of the beauties about bridal intimacy and romance, I know we can experience Jesus and the Father in many different ways, but I really believe he wants us to experience the fullness of him as Father, as lover, as the bridegroom, as our brother in every aspect. And so, it's so beautiful. One of the dreams I had as well, I had a dream about... it was soon after we were married, and in this dream, I dreamt that I was peering around. There was this beautiful place. I was in a forest somewhere, and I was peering around this tree, and I saw this beautiful procession of people coming, and it was hundreds and thousands of people, and as they started to come, I was so ecstatic. I was so excited because I knew this is the bride. This is the bridal procession. And as this bridal procession came closer, I noticed that there were many, thousands, hundreds and thousands. But the ones, there were definitely a distinction of the ones in front. Sorry, guys. But the ones in front had these beautiful white garments on. and this joy, this exuberance. They were dancing and they were had these tambourines and they were absolutely exuberant. And as I looked around there at them, I noticed the others also had beautiful white clothes, but it wasn't like there was something about these other clothes that were almost blinding me in the dark. You know, I was just blinded by that beauty of the radiance, and I realized that in my spirit, because you know things in the spirit, that they had actually, they were the surrender was complete. And I do believe, I mean, we've prayed for people that have committed suicide. God showed me they're going to be in heaven. We've prayed for people that have done awful things, and I know they're in heaven. But I do believe, and it's not God's selection, it's our choice, the surrender that we have as a bride. And so, yeah, and just before I share this, I know the couple of years I had on my own as a single woman, as a single parent, I know in my heart there was a surrender for those few years before I met Gunter. And I know the road wasn't easy. And at times it would have been easier just to make a choice, a second choice. But I know that surrender, there was a purpose, there was a higher purpose. And I wanted the higher road. And I feel in the body of Christ, you know, to me, if it was like I want the whole package. I don't just want to go to church because I've done that and it's boring and it's tedious and it's effort. I want to be like, oh, I can't wait to see my lover, you know, that excitement. And so I feel like God is wanting to restore and rekindle that first love, because you know it's like that in a marriage. I just thank God for Gunst because he's quite a romantic, but I know he's walked a road of recognizing the responsibility to stir that romance. And it is so important that we do that, not at the works, but to really pursue, and really it's about surrender. There's no work involved in the surrender. Gunter was speaking to me this week about some love notes that he sometimes feels God hides for him and for his bride, you know, little messages. And, you know, and he said if anything ever happened to him, he would, and he had time, he would make sure he's leaving little love notes and messages for me. And, you know, and I feel that's the excitement the Holy Spirit wants us to have. So the Song of Solomons is really, Brian Simmons talks about it, and all the early church fathers, including Augustine, recognized that it's actually a picture of the bride and the bridegroom. It's not some story about how to have, to talk about premarital, you know, when you get married, how, about sex. It's not that. You can look at that way if you want, but it's actually, it's a higher picture that at some point in our life that we call to come into that bridal chamber, you know, where it's about him. It's like face to face, it's intimacy. And I really feel that intimacy is what he's stirring us to now. And that's what's going to maintain our faith. That is the lover where, you know, love sick. I know we told you last time Gunter couldn't eat for 6 weeks when we were courting because he was love sick. And I remember being love sick for Jesus, where I would get up from the table. Hilton's been not eating for how long? I don't know, a couple of weeks. I know that love sick feeling where I don't want a meal because I want to go to the room and be with Jesus. And I feel the Spirit is stirring that intimacy with us again. You know, that intimacy, that romance, that, you know, you just, there's a trust that comes out of it. You know, there's a trust when you're romancing someone. There's such an intimacy and a trust. And I really feel right now, you know, marriage has been so under attack. There's so much division. I believe that romance is so important right now. Marriages get stirred up again to intimacy. God wants to do something special. So Gunst just suggested we just play this little just this little video clip, and then I'm going to pass on to Gunst. you just turn the music up here? So just before I hand over to Guns, I actually felt that our wedding was God's gift back to me of a, almost like an allegory of what the bride, the wedding was going to be like. You know, our marriage was going to be a picture of like heaven, like the bride and bridegroom coming together. And I really believe that is prophetically how God intended marriage to be a picture of the bride and bridegroom. And we saw that redemption in our marriage of two families coming together. We took covenant. And I remember the whole courtship, there was such an innocence and a purity about it, how God just gave us visions. He would give us visions of lions, just these two fat lions so content in the fields. And he would romance us, and he would, we would just find ourselves at the same place at the same time. And right through our courtship, and even on the marriage, the wedding day, everything was absolutely perfect. It took me half an hour to sort out everybody's clothes, the kids, everybody, which you know is impossible with kiddies that are going into teenage. Everything was just like, it just flowed, and it was effortless. And, you know, but at the same time, on the wedding day, behind the scenes, everything was going wrong. there were so many things that weren't working, but I was so totally, absolutely bowled over with the love of God. I was in such a glory, and I was laughing and crying the whole day with just, this is who I am. I can't like be something I'm not, but I was totally filled with joy. And while I'm saying my marriage vows, I'm looking out the window, and the lady supposed to do the food and everything, she was having a disaster crisis. She hadn't even started yet. The wedding's almost finished. Things like that. And there was such a peace on me, and I was so rest. I knew everything was going to come into order, and everything went perfect. And I just feel to picture right now, God wants his bride in rest, you know? He wants us in joy. He doesn't want us focused on the noise. You know, whenever there's something glorious, there's always a noise at the same time. He wants our focus on him. Because in that, I know those 6 weeks, I only had 6 weeks to prepare, that locked into his embrace, I saw perfection in everything, purpose in everything. And I feel there's a preparation now of the bride. You know, I don't know if it's going to be 5 months, 5 years, 50 years, 500 years, I don't know. But I feel there's a sense of an imminence. And I feel that preparation of, you know, it's time for romance. It's time to get into the bridal chamber. And it's the bridegroom, it's the purpose, the job of the Holy Spirit to prepare us. So just like my wedding, my preparation was surrender. You know, the inadequacy, my own strength. How do I do this? And God just did it, put the wedding together. Everything was perfect. And I really believe that there's a preparation. The Holy Spirit's preparing his bride. You know, we don't have to analyze everything going right or wrong in our lives. He's doing it. And but our part is to partake in it, to surrender. you know, our going to heaven, it's done. But there's definitely, we can either be in a marriage which is just ho-hum, and, you know, we're married, or we can participate in the benefits of that romance, of the excitement, of the romance, and co-laboring together. And so I just want to encourage us. I really believe that I've been listening to Gunter's sermon this whole week, and I've been blown away because it's so beautiful, the downloads, impartation God's been giving him. And sometimes it's too intimate for a session like this. But it's not a task to walk in intimacy. To be honest, I wouldn't have been a Christian if it was any other way, because I'm not a good person to just show up and do stuff, you know? I've got to be passionate. There's got to be a desire. There's got to be something. And I've never, ever waned. And I believe the extent of our surrender to, you know, to allowing the work of the Spirit is what it's about. So just to encourage every one of you, just surrender, allow him to take over, and just surrender whatever those things are in your life. You know, it's we don't have an easy life by no means, but we've learned to surrender. It's almost like our go-to everyone, surrender, let go. And in that, we've seen the most beautiful life God's created for us and our family.
Thank you, Trish. Thank you. The Holy Spirit, we just thank you that you continue to draw us tonight. Show us our bridegroom. Holy Spirit, show us our bridegroom. Show us Jesus. And unveil who we are, that we are the bride of Christ, that we are eternally loved, that you've given us your own beauty, Lord Jesus, that you see perfect beauty in every one of us, a unique beauty in every one of us, and you are overwhelmed with love for us. And you will not rest till we fully realize your love for every one of us, and we love you the same way that you love us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This is what you've created. This is what all creation is about. The final consummation of the bridegroom and his bride, and reigning with the bridegroom from heaven to earth. Thank you, Jesus. So Jesus is looking for a bride who loves him as much as he loves her, who will live the higher life, reigning with him from the throne in heaven over the nations. But middle of August, I just heard Jesus, I had a vision of Jesus and the bride, and Jesus said to his bride, "Will you love me as much as I loved you?" And I was included in that bride. And I realized how totally unable we are able to do that in our own strength. Then I saw the bride and Jesus sitting at a table, and them both drinking from like a goblet of wine, which was actually his blood. And the bride was getting totally intoxicated on his love, as she realized, as she was getting revelation of how much he loved her. She was getting totally intoxicated. So Jesus is always drawing us, his bride. And if we just sensitize our hearts, we will hear him. He's like the ultimate bridegroom that's always, always longing for intimacy, that loves us with a passion that this world cannot describe. So on a bit later in the month, last month, I just saw, Jesus, the Holy Spirit just showed me Jesus is at the door and waiting for the bride to be ready and to say, "Come, my Lord Jesus." Just like in a normal wedding, you know, the bridegroom is ready and he's waiting for his bride, and the bride is making herself ready and sometimes taking a bit of time. So the bridegroom, he's always been ready, but he's waiting for his bride to make herself ready. And as I said, to love him as much as he loves her. So that same night, the Holy Spirit was just showing me, you know, the price that Jesus paid for his bride. So we know, you know, the counts through the Gospels, it says Jesus was tied up like a criminal. He allowed himself, you know, to be the sacrifice, beaten with rods. His beard was plucked out. He was spat on, clothed with a royal robe, mocked, whipped, nailed to the cross for his bride. His last words on the cross were, "My bride, it is finished, my bride." When the sword pierced his side, blood and water came out of his side. His bride was birthed out of his side, just like Eve came out of Adam. We've come out of Jesus. Jesus is totally drunk with love for his bride. He sees her perfect and his perfect beauty inside of her. Then I saw the bride. She's been drinking the wine of his love, and she is drunk with his love for her bridegroom. She now loves Jesus with the same love with which he loves her. So Jesus has been getting, the Holy Spirit has been getting the bride ready. She's ready to be consummated to her bridegroom. Jesus is crazily in love with, she is crazily in love with him and is prepared to go to the nations and if necessary to be martyred for him. She has made herself ready for her bridegroom and together with the Holy Spirit cries, "Come, my Lord Jesus." So Revelation 19:7 says, so remember I said the book of Revelation is the unveiling of Jesus Christ and specifically the unveiling of Christ in his bride. So Revelation 19:7, so as we know, a lot of the book of Revelation is about just the chaos that's going to happen in the last days in the earth, and we're experiencing a lot of that now. But Revelation 19:7, so in the midst of the chaos, the bride, God is using that very pressure of what's going on in the world to actually get the bride to a place where she seeks him with all her heart. She's desperate. She's no longer loving the things of this world as much as her bridegroom. She has eyes only for her bridegroom. So Revelation 19:7 says, "Let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him. For the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself." So the time of for the unveiling of the bride has come, and the Holy Spirit is unveiling the full beauty and glory of Christ inside of his bride. So that's the only thing that will stop, you know, the church just going into apostasy and just backsliding in the midst of this pressure that's happening in the world, is actually a revelation of who she really is. Like we know, you know, Simba, he was just like, he'd got to the place where he lost his identity. And, you know, the Bible talks, Revelation talks about the Laodicean church, the end time church, as being quite lukewarm, almost like double-minded, like loving the things of this world and loving God, but not being single-minded. And so until, you know, the Holy Spirit reveals the full identity, like when Simba looked into that water and he saw who he really was and he came back into his full identity. Until that time, we know that back at home in Pride Rock, there was chaos going on because Scar had taken over and the hyenas were ruling. But when Simba realized who he really was, he came back and he took Scar on and he started reigning again and the kingdom came back into its original beauty. So we are living in that time where God wants his bride to rise up. So he's drawing, he's currently, like Trish has been saying, he's actually drawing his bride. And just like a normal, you know, like when I met Trish and we realized that we were attracted to each other, I started romancing her. And so in the same way, like she says, you know, little love notes or little gifts or whatever, Jesus is, he's the ultimate bridegroom. And when we open our hearts to him, you know, he will actually draw us, like Song of Solomon is that ultimate picture of the bridegroom and the bride, which is every one of you. And so, you know, it starts off and it says, so the bride she doesn't really initiate the love. And so she starts off and she says, draw me, I will run after you. And she says, kiss me with the kisses of your mouth. So what that's talking about is the Holy Spirit brings revelation. When we make time for Jesus, he brings revelation of, the Holy Spirit brings revelation of Jesus' love for you specifically. And, you know, Jesus loves you in a way that only you really, he knows all about you. And he will love you in a way that really just makes you alive. So, yes, I've had for the last 25 years or so, I've just had that experience of just Jesus just drawing me and singing love songs to me. And often he sings like secular love songs, but it's something that means, it's meaningful to me, and he wants to draw every one of us like that. So, yeah. So Jesus is here right now, you know, he is so, his return is so imminent. You know, to those who are listening and those whose hearts are sensitive, you just know he's here. He's so close. So for the last, I think I've mentioned this before a couple of times, Jesus has been saying to me, he's been waking me up at midnight, saying it's midnight. In Matthew 25, you know, it speaks about, at midnight there was a shout, behold, the bridegroom comes. Go out to meet him. So there's a call right now in the midst of the chaos going on in the world. The bridegroom is saying, are you ready for the wedding feast? Are you ready to be married? So I'll just read that. While the bridegroom lingered and was slow in coming, they all began nodding their heads and they all fell asleep. So the church has largely been asleep. But at midnight, there was a shout. Behold, the bridegroom comes. Go out to meet him. Then all the virgins got up and put their lamps in order. So it's time for the bride to be ready. So Revelation 19 says, yeah, let us rejoice and shout for joy, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and the bride has prepared herself. She's been permitted to dress in fine linen, yeah, dazzling and white. So the time for the bride to be unveiled. So the time for the unveiling of the bride has come, and the Holy Spirit is unveiling the full beauty and glory of Christ inside of his bride. 2 Thessalonians 1:10 says, he is coming to be glorified in the saints and to be marveled at in all who have believed. So the Holy Spirit wants to, like I've said, he wants to unveil the full beauty of Christ inside of you. Because as we know, the Bible says, Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And when we realize, like Simba, when he looked into that water of reflection and he saw his father in him, everything came into order. He suddenly realized who he really was. And when we realize, when, as the bride, I'm speaking about the unveiling of the bride, when the bride realizes who she is, when she sees her bridegroom in her, she sees the full beauty of who she is. And she comes into her true identity. So in Revelation 3, it says, he who overcomes, I will grant him to sit beside me on my throne, as I myself overcame and sat down beside my father on his throne. So there's God is wanting a bride, like Trish said, as we surrender to his love. So this is not talking about salvation, because we are saved by grace through faith. And it's speaking about a bride who will actually sit with Christ on his throne and rule over the nations. So that's speaking here on earth. Okay, ruling over the nations of the earth. And that's speaking about people who are saved, who will be in front of the throne, but the bride will be on the throne ruling with Christ over the nations. So like it says, you know, in Matthew 25, it speaks about five of the virgins were ready and five were not. So it's not speaking about salvation. They were all virgins, which speaks about that they have been, their sins had been forgiven, they had been washed clean. But only five of the virgins were actually ready. And Jesus said to the other virgins, I don't know you, because they hadn't spent time with him. So it's as we spend time with Jesus, we come, the Holy Spirit brings us into a revelation. We experience the kisses of our bridegroom, which is through the Holy Spirit, awakening us to love and awakening us to who we really are. Yeah. As I said, I saw God gave me this vision of Jesus and his bride, and Jesus was holding his bride by her hands, and he was looking into her eyes, and he was just so in love with his bride. And the Holy Spirit was standing next to them. It was like this marriage that was happening, and it was like the Holy Spirit was the pastor. He was marrying Jesus and his bride. And the bride came into a revelation of how much her bridegroom loves her. And she actually became overwhelmed with his love for her. And she just started almost like falling over with such a revelation of his love. I'm just trusting for, like, we're going to play a couple of songs, and we're just going to ask the Holy Spirit to really minister to every one of you and really bring that, just reveal the love of Jesus for you individually, because it's so important that we know that we know how much he loves us, because it's only his love that can awaken us. So it's like Sleeping Beauty, you know. She was, like I said, the church has been largely asleep. But we know the story of Sleeping Beauty. The prince came and he kissed the princess awake. And so Jesus is wanting to kiss his bride awake. And it's when, you know, there's stories about the martyrs in the first century church. They were so in love with Jesus that they didn't fear death. You know, they knew that death was just a doorway into his presence, just being with the person they loved. And so, you know, there's a lady called Basilia Schlink, and she mentored and discipled a group of ladies in Germany into bridal intimacy. And she just said, you know, she prophesied, this is probably in the 60s or so, she said, you know, things in the world are going to get so hectic, and it's only bridal intimacy that will actually, like, allow the church or the bride to stand in the midst of the persecution that's coming. So, yeah, so I think the invitation is there. Jesus is looking for a bride that loves him as much as he loves her. And he's always drawing us, always wanting romance with his bride. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, says, my beloved speaks and says to me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. For behold, the winter's past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth. The time of the singing of birds has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree puts forth and ripens her green figs, and the vines are in blossom and give forth their fragrance. So Jesus is saying this to you right now. Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. So I went with them, and when we were climbing the rocky steps up the hillside, my beloved shepherd said to me, O my dove, while you are here in the seclusion of the clefts and the solid rock, in the sheltered and secret place of the cliff, let me see your face, let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. My heart was touched. So the bride, she is in love with Jesus. She only has eyes for her bridegroom. Jesus is her everything. So the Holy Spirit wants to draw us into a place, into that bridal chamber with Jesus, where we actually experience his love, where we are overwhelmed with his love. So, you know, this one guy, Eric Gilmore, he says so often we come into, you know, a place of worship or we spend time with Jesus and we come out unchanged. And the reason why we often come out unchanged is because we come with petitions, you know. We come with all our needs, all our, you know, we come with petitions with before God. And he says, you know, we need to just come with adoration. You know, like the Bible says, come into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. And as we just spend time with the Lord and we just adore Jesus and we just confess who he is, he draws us and he overwhelms us and shows us how much he loves us. And, you know, like we know, it's we love him because he first loved us. So he wants us to get to a place where he is our everything. And we are no longer distracted or self-focused or overwhelmed by our circumstances. So the bridegroom, Jesus, only has eyes for his bride. He has shed his blood for her. He lives only for her. So that's speaking about every one of you. So Song of Solomon 6 says there are 60 queens and 80 concubines and virgins without number, but my dove, my undefiled and perfect one, stands alone above them all. So Jesus loves every one of you like there's no one else. You know, years ago, before I met Trish, I had an encounter with Jesus like that, and I got to a place where I said, Jesus, you cannot love me this much. So he wants us to get to a place where we come into the full revelation of his love for us individually. So he loves every one of us like there's no one else. So Lord, Holy Spirit, we just pray that you shine your light into every one of our hearts right now. And just reveal Jesus, our bridegroom, inside of us. Thank you, Lord, that you're not willing to be a distant God. Lord, you've come to consummate us to yourself. You want to marry us. You are looking for a bride that knows your love, that is overwhelmed by your love for her. Sure. That is constantly living in an experience of your love for her. So we just thank you right now, Jesus. You live inside of every one of us. I just pray that you overwhelm every one of us with your love, that we will no longer know your love just by understanding, but we will live in the full experience of bridal love. So we just say, come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that you love us. I just pray, Lord Jesus, that you start singing love songs to every person here, whether male or female, because we are all your bride, that you draw us into the bridal chamber, that Holy Spirit, you kiss us with the kisses of Jesus, that you bring us into such a love relationship with Jesus that we would feel that we are his only bride because he loves us so much. and that all fear would leave us. That though the earth be shaken, the mountains fall into the sea, we will not be afraid because we see you constantly in us. Jesus, our bridegroom, thank you for your love. I just pray today that you just overwhelm everyone here with your love. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I just pray that you reveal that full love of the bridegroom, Jesus, to every person here. Thank you, Lord, that we were created for love and you want us to live our whole lives out of that intimacy with you. Thank you, Jesus. You said this is eternal life, to know the Father, to know his Son. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Pierre, could you play the next song, please? We'll just continue to pray as we just play this song. Please just listen to the words, these amazing words in this song. It's talking about Jesus. Jesus has just been showing me that we're on the verge of a Holy Spirit revival where God, you know, the Bible says in the last days. The last days started at Pentecost, but it's right till the second coming of Christ. So we're living in the last days where it says, Hosea chapter 6 says, after 2 days, I will revive you. On the third day, I will lift you up that you will live before me. I will come to you like the rain, the latter rain that waters the earth. So I really believe, I'm so expectant, God is going to pour out his Spirit. The Bible says upon all flesh, upon both believers and unbelievers. and the believers will fall in love with Jesus. And they will be fearless. They will no longer compromise. Unbelievers will come into a revelation that Jesus is God and will come to surrender to Him. So I'm really expectant. I know God said revival is imminent. So we're going to experience. Bible says He's coming to be glorified in those who have believed, to be marveled at. So there's such a glory. There's such an imminent glory. Like it says in Romans 8, it says the whole of creation is waiting for the sons of God to manifest. I really believe it's now. That's what the Holy Spirit's been telling me. So just, you know, Trish and I have been looking at some of the past revivals. Like the Welsh revival in the 1900s. And it started when a young girl in a church meeting, she just got up and she said, 13-year-old girl, Florrie Evans, she just said, "I love you, Jesus, with all my heart." And it was obviously the Holy Spirit. And I just want to say right now, I love you, Jesus, with all my heart. I love you, Jesus. And if you echo that, just speak that. Just speak that right now. Thank you, Jesus. We love you because you first loved us. As she said that, revival broke out. So the Holy Spirit was poured out on the people and throughout Wales and further other countries. And people just came into a first love relationship with Jesus where they just were willing to give up everything and no longer live lukewarm lives. So, Lord, we thank you that only you can do it, Holy Spirit. And we say together, the bride, the Spirit and the bride, say, "Come, Lord Jesus." We say, "Come, Lord Jesus. Manifest your glory." And we pray, Holy Spirit, unveil Christ inside of his bride. Manifest your glory. Manifest your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Just going to play one more song and then we'll close. Thank you. I'm just thinking of that scripture. Peter says, he says, without having seen him, we love him and thrill with an inexpressible, triumphant, heavenly joy. I just pray, Lord Jesus, cause every person here and those watching to fall in love with Jesus, to know the love of Jesus. What is the height, the depth, the length, the breadth, and the width of his love by experience? To be overwhelmed so that, Lord, they can live for nothing else but Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Awaken your bride. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Yeah. You're welcome to go now. We're going to close, but I'm just going to play two songs, which are secular songs, which, you know, like two of the songs that Jesus sings to me. But they from my past, so you might not be able to identify with them, but they're fun. Okay. Yes.
I just felt like that there'd been like such a jealousy in the spirit against attack against the body to almost discourage the bride. And I just felt like the Holy Spirit's just, you know, just to really this refreshing of his presence over you. I just pray such a refreshing. I just feel there's an empowering God wants to do, of an encouragement for you to really draw into the presence of God. You know, there's so many things to distract us right now and so many other things, but I just sense the Holy Spirit wants to draw you into that place of intimacy where you have such a security and such a stability. And I just pray over you that whatever discouragement, you know, when a bully comes and he's so jealous because you've got something, and I just, you know, to recognize that God is, your identity is so secure in Christ. And I just speak over every one of you that Christ is your identity, that the fullness of Christ lives in you, that those things are facades, they have no authority over you, your life, that Christ, he's that lion inside of you. And we just speak resurrection life. I just felt like stuff was just breaking off people tonight. Stuff, remnants of almost like trying to shut one down and trying to make one small. And we just release you from any of the limitations, any of the distractions and the harassments and the reasoning, and just everything that would distract you from who Christ is in you. And we just speak a new joy. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And, you know, there's a joy God is releasing in the body of Christ. The kingdom has been established. There's so many exciting things. And so, you know, we affect the atmosphere. And so I just want to encourage you, shake off that stuff that wants to sit on you. And in your heart, when you align with him, that presence just, there comes a boldness. There comes a steadfastness. And I just pray that over all of you, such a stability, that you're stable in Christ. You're a new creation, that the fullness of Christ lives in you. And we just speak the boldness and the resurrection life to rise up on the inside of you, that Christ would be seen in Jesus' name.
So during worship, I don't know, I just felt to come up. I don't know if it's anybody in here, but Mon got a picture of x-ray, like a vividly a picture of lungs. So I don't know if anybody's got issue with lungs actually in here, like breathing problems or just something specific. We just get lungs. If it's not anybody in here, maybe whoever's watching, and obviously I know the one song. Okay, I thought so. Yeah, when I walked to the toilet, I had a feeling it was you two guys, but I don't want to put you guys on the spot. So I know the one song that's going to come on. Sure. I just declare, as you hear that song, you'll get your miracle.
Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
God spoke it into being, because like you say, I just felt my heart, my lovely lady got the picture, and she was actually saying healthy lungs. That's what the x-ray will show. So we declare that and speak that over you.
Thank you. So I'm just going to play these two songs. I'm sure you all, you know, it's us that divide songs into Christian songs, secular songs. But I believe all beauty comes from Jesus. All romance comes from Jesus. He is the all. And so, you know, he's, like I've said, he plays secular songs to me that just fun songs. But it just, you know, it's where you're at the moment. So I just pray the same for you guys, you know, that God will just wake you up with, can be any song or whatever, just to show you how much he loves you and just to awaken you to love. So can we play the next one? Thanks. So, yeah, it's an old song. I think it was in the 50s. So, you know, like God just, the other day, I'm just walking into a supermarket and he starts playing this song to me. And it was, you know, when I was young, it was very, very, I liked the song. And so, but really God wants to bring you to a place. He is crazily in love with every one of you. Like literally, he loves you like there's no one else. And he wants you to know that love. So, you know, once you know that, you can be open to his drawing. You know, like Song of Solomon says, draw me, I will run after you. Kiss me with the kisses. The whole of Song of Solomon is a picture of the church, of where Jesus is drawing her, where initially she feels, you know, I'm so dark, you know, I'm like, got so much nonsense on me, and we all have, to the place where she gets to at the end of Song of Solomon, where she says, my beloved is mine, and I'm his. His desire is for me. So she's so confident. God wants you in that place where, you know, I just want to say, this is life. Everything else is just details. Once you know the love of Jesus, there's nothing else worth living for. Can we just listen to the last one? So the last one is about, it's called Mr. Fire Eyes. Mr. Fire Eyes is Jesus. Okay, so you know the Bible says, his face shines like the sun, his eyes are like fire, his body is like lightning. And you know, he wants you to see him. He wants you to see your bridegroom. Once you've seen Jesus, you are spoiled for the rest. He wants you to see him, and all fear will leave you when you see him. And the Holy Spirit, all you have to do is just ask the Holy Spirit, show me Jesus. So can we play that one in your close?
Mr. Fire Eyes, from the start you stole my heart, not just part, but all my heart. Mr. Fire Eyes, I'm up and down like a clown, running round and around over you. Tell me why I start to churn, my cheeks will burn, I get concerned, my lips they yearn for a kiss from you. Oh, tell me what to do with it.
So the amazing thing is Jesus plays these songs to me. So, you know, out of the blue. So that shows me what he's like. He is really amazing. He's such an amazing person. So, Lord, we just thank you as we go home. We just thank you, Lord, that we are in covenant with you, with our families, that we are in Christ, that we are in you, Father God, in Christ, and that every promise is yes and amen in Christ. Thank you, Lord, that in the midst of chaos, we can be full of joy. We can experience heaven on earth. And we can know that even if we go through shaking, it will not harm us. But Lord, the shaking might be to get rid of unnecessary baggage because you love us so much. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
If anyone would like prayer, please just come up if anyone would like prayer.
Stay off.